Hello and welcome to Quarantine Conversations. IU, Indiana University, Arts and Humanities confronts COVID-19. I'm Ed Comitale, director of the IU Bloomington Arts and Humanities Council, and we're in the fifth week of a seven-week program dedicated to arts and humanities perspectives and frameworks for exploring and grappling with the current pandemic, as well as many of its historical, social, and cultural dimensions. This is an interdisciplinary discussion. We've been hearing from professors of history, literature, philosophy, religious studies, critical race studies, and medical humanities, as well as artists and actors, singers, musicians, playwrights, poets, and fiction writers. These are my colleagues at IU Bloomington and IU PUI, and they are here to convey why the values and perspectives of the arts and humanities matters today. These are hard-hitting times, and these are hard-hitting thinkers, and they're here to make a case for the value of their work in today's social and historical moment. Humanists on our program have been providing historical context for the pandemic, exploring cultural differences in responses to the pandemic, examining the imagery and language with which we discuss the disease, and analyzing different forms of expression, as well as the values that shape our ethical responses and clarifying the moral dimensions of the way we live today. Artists have been helping us shape feelings into expression, connecting us across vast distances with their work, using their understanding of materials and the qualities of good design to build useful equipment for handling our responses to the pandemic. Importantly, this is also a collaborative program across campuses and across the state. I'd like to give a shout out to Jason Kelly, my co-host and co-director for this program. He's the director of the IUPUI Arts and Humanities Institute, as well as Leah Nemius, director of programs and community engagement for Indiana Humanities. Thank you so much for your work on this program, Jason and Leah. And I'd also like to give a very special welcome to the alumni who are watching tonight, especially those from IU Bloomington's College of Arts and Sciences and IUPUI's School of Liberal Arts and Heron School of Art and Design. For sure, this is an interesting time to be an academic or a theorist or even a thinker. It's an interesting time to be a humanist. I've been thinking recently about a series published in the Los Angeles Review of Books by Brad Evans. Brad Evans is a political philosopher, critical theorist, and a writer. And his series is called The Quarantine Files, Thinkers in Self-Isolation. And it addresses many of the dilemmas that humanists are facing today as they continue to pursue their work, often sheltered at home. Brad Evans has some interesting things to say about what it means to be a thinker and confronting the overwhelming nature of the current calamity. This is what he writes. Like many authors, I want to say something. Partly I now see for my own sanity, but I didn't know where to begin. I just knew that I was becoming increasingly concerned, not only for the welfare of others, but of my loved ones, family, friends, and companions alike. Writing has always been my therapy to the horrors of the world, and I still maintain there's no better reason to write or express in any medium than to feel the world's beauty and pain. But was it all simply too close or too reactionary? Brad's work doesn't just address the incredible intensity of the current moment and the difficulty of thinking clearly about it. He also talks about the ways in which information is shared and knowledge is communicated, the devices, particularly the technology that we use to exchange with each other. There's a very strange situation for academics today. They are both alone and yet, because of the internet, bombarded by ideas from all sides. Brad writes, there certainly was no shortage of reflections being offered. Everyone is now an expert, it seems, and yet never have we felt more in the dark about outcomes, even the most basic questioning whether there'll be enough food to go around. But I couldn't find the words to do justice to this unfolding tragedy, except to repeat the warnings from history and the need to be vigilant to its political effects. I now see my inertia was revealing of a deeper fear and a sense of foreboding, that of being alone and writing alone. I'm not sure that quarantine conversations can address all of these issues, but tonight's panel contains three powerhouse thinkers that are going to help us out. The theme for tonight is representing illness, contagion, and death, and we'll be exploring works of art and literature that might give shape to our experience today, works that help us perhaps organize and structure our ideas and feelings that we have in response to the pandemic. I think you'll find that not just art and literature, but the way that art and literature expresses and shapes feeling is an important part of each talk tonight. A lot of what we will say will be elucidating involves the continued effective power of art, past and present. One key feature of our program is that I've asked each of our speakers to choose an object to start their talk. And tonight you'll be hearing about a famous bell, a famous skull, and a haunting sculpture. I'm very eager to get started. Our first guest is Patricia Claire Ingham. Patty is a professor and chair of English at IU Bloomington. She studies English and medieval studies, and she's an affiliate of the Department of Religious Studies. Her work assesses the reach and limits of the imagination, both during the Middle Ages and the medieval period as a whole. It is deeply interdisciplinary and wonderfully wide-ranging work. It rose boldly from Chaucer to Arthurian romance, to utopian literature, to science fiction and film, and it is groundbreaking in its use of psychoanalytic, post-colonial, and gender theories. Patty's most recent book is The Medieval New, Ambivalence in an Age of Innovation, a study of the surprising preoccupation with newness and novelty in literature, scientific, and religious discourses of the 12th through 16th century. I'm very excited to hear Patty speak on the literature of contagion and its emotional resonance. Please join me in welcoming Patty Ingham.
Thank you so much. It's really wonderful to be here. And I'm. It's been a really interesting provocation to think about literature of contagion for this particular event. This is a course that I've taught over the years from time to time, and I'm really looking forward to thinking today about a particular science fiction novel by a great author named Connie Willis called The Doomsday Book. Takes as its primary setting, time travel between two ages. In moments like these, it really does feel a little bit like the times are out of joint. And we feel, I think, that keenly. It's also an issue that is regularly engaged in literature of contagion. So my conversation tonight is based on a course that I've taught at the undergraduate level a couple of different times. And we look in that course at a number of different types of literatures, including film. A lot of these texts that we've read in this class have been in the news recently in our own time of contagion. Steven Soderbergh's 2011 film Contagion, perhaps most famously, but also Camus' The Plague from 1947, Daniel Defoe's Journal of a Plague Year from the 18th century. And then in my own period, my own medieval period, Boccaccio's The Decameron, which sets up a tale-telling entertainment among a group of people who have gone off to the countryside to escape the plague that's raging nearby. Tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about a lesser-known work. This is Connie Willis's Doomsday Book, in which a postgraduate history student by the name of Kivrin is studying medieval history at Oxford and comes to travel between the 14th and the 21st centuries. It's a deeply moving story that focuses on pandemic in two eras simultaneously, the 14th century Black Death and a 21st century flu pandemic, not unlike our own virus. So I want to start right now with, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the synopsis of Willis's story. I hope some of you have read it, but I don't expect that all of you had. So I want to start with my provocation, which is I'm going to share with you a sound. So listen to the bells of Big Tom in Oxford Christ Church Tower. I've begun with the bells of Big Tom, in part because bells serve as a kind of leitmotif throughout Willis's text. So let me tell you a little bit about the way the bells and books become uncanny objects in Willis. And now I'm going to share with you my screen. Connie Willis's Doomsday Book, written in 1992, is a deeply affecting story in which Oxford's bells prove to be untimely, passing between the 21st century and the 14th century. It was first published in 1992, as I said, and is a multi-award winning book. The Hugo Award, which is an award given to science fiction, also the Nebula Award and the Locust Award. And part of what's so marvelous about Willis's work is the way it sort of sets in motion a double pandemic. We are oscillating between two chronologies, two times. Oxford University, the year is 2054, and Kivrin Engel, a time traveling doctoral student who is studying medieval history, is anxious to do on-site research in the 14th century. This is 2054, and so by this time, one of the primary modes of historical research is time travel. And so Kivrin really begs her major professor, her mentor, and kind of her father figure, Professor Dunworthy, to allow her to go back to the Middle Ages so that she can do some on-site research. He's not so enthusiastic about this idea and feels that the medieval period's a little too dangerous. But finally, after many, many efforts of persuasion, she succeeds and is sent back to a town named Shrividan in Oxfordshire in 1348. She was aiming to go to the year 1320, which was a perfectly fine, normal year. Nothing terribly catastrophic happened at that time, but for because of a variety of different technical mistakes, she ended up arriving in Oxfordshire just before Christmas in 1348. That is, just as the Black Death arrived in the town in which she emerged. So the characters that you have are in these two simultaneous times. Kivrin and her professor Dunworthy, they're going to be really the focus of my comments today. And then in Shrividan, in Oxfordshire, Eloise, who is the lady of the manor, Rosamond, Eloise's eldest daughter, who's about 15, Agnes, Eloise's youngest daughter, 6 years old, who is enamored of a puppy by the name of Blackie, and Father Roche, a local cleric who is not himself literate. He's kind of rustic. His form of liturgy is not particularly highly tuned. He makes a lot of mistakes, but he turns out in some ways to be the kind of conscience of the book. At the same time, in these two places, by virtue of the time travel narrative, both are experiencing pandemics. In Oxford in 2054, thanks to a virus that was let loose from an archaeological dig, a flu that dates back to the 14th century has revisited Oxford in 2054, causing widespread pandemic and leading to the quarantine of that city. And of course, as Kivrin arrives in Oxfordshire in the 13th century, she arrives just at the time that the plague is coming to this town. All right, so Kivrin has gone back to to Oxfordshire, and as she's involved in the lives, coming to know the lives of these medieval people in which she finds herself, the plague just starts ravaging this small village, and many of the locals are falling ill. The children, the impoverished members of the village, first of all. And Kivrin is herself not succumbing to the illness. And so she involves herself with Father Roche in taking care of the inhabitants. And here, right in about two-thirds of the way in the book, we hear Kivrin relating one of the a bit of her reflection in the midst of her time in Oxfordshire. One little bit of detail that I've neglected to tell you at this point. Kivrin has come equipped with a whole set of gadgets, not the least of which is a recorder that's been embedded in her wrist so that she can make a note of to herself of what she sees and hears and what she experiences. She directs this this journal to Dunworthy, her father figure that she's left back in Oxford 2054. And so she's speaking to him in some of these quotations that I'm gonna be reading to you today. So this is the first one that she that I'm talking about today. People have really started dying. Things are not going well in the small town. And Kivrin says to the recorder, "We can hear the plague." I'm having trouble seeing my. "The villages toll the death knell after a burial. 9 strokes for a man, 3 for a woman, 1 for a baby, and then an hour of steady tolling. Escote, a local village, had 2 this morning, and Osney has told continuously since yesterday. The bell in the southwest that I could hear when I first came through has stopped. I don't know whether that means that the plague is finished there or whether there is no one left alive to ring the bell." So this bell that Kivrin is hearing was a primary way of communicating the spread of desperation, the spread of the pandemic in the local communities. At the time that Kivrin is experiencing this in 1348 Oxford, Dunworthy, her mentor, has taken ill in 2054 Oxford. And here he too hears an avatar of a 14th century bell. He's in the hospital in this scene, just 15 pages after the episode we just heard from Kivrin. And we hear the narrator telling us that Dunworthy tried to press the button to call the nurse, but he couldn't find it. There was a handbell on the bedstand next to the bed, and he reached for it, but there was no strength in his fingers, and it clattered to the floor. It made an endless, horrible sound, like some nightmarish great tom, but nobody came. Great Tom, the bell that Dunworthy references, at that very moment that he references it, and even today, is housed in the Christchurch Tower, the loudest bell in Oxford. It weighs 6.25 tons and was moved from the 12th century Osney Abbey after the dissolution of the monasteries. Originally called Mary, Great Tom was moved from Osney Abbey to St. Fridsworth Church in 1545, after which at some point it was renamed Tom. Now, the first time I taught this book, I didn't quite realize that there was not only an intertextual connection between bells, between Kivrin's bell on the one hand and Dunworthy's bell, the nightmarish Great Tom that he experiences while in the hospital and in delirium. There was that intertextual reference, but I didn't quite realize that there was also an extra textual reference, because Great Tom was none other than that bell that I just played for you at the beginning of this presentation. And it was also exactly the very bell that Kivrin hears as Osney, tolling continuously since yesterday. So this bell, in an uncanny way, is a material object that bridges Kivrin's pandemic in the 14th century, the devastation that's happening to this village about 20 minutes outside of Oxford, bridges that with Dunworthy's experience in the 21st century in the hospital suffering delirium relative to the 21st century flu pandemic. One of the things we are constantly being brought into in Willis's Doomsday Book is the degree to which history repeats, but even more to the point, resonates across the centuries. It's not only that Kivrin and Dunworthy are each experiencing the devastation of pandemic in these two, 700 years apart, these two very different places, but they're experiencing at the same time and being tied together through the resonances, the sonorous tolling of the bells that ring for the dead. So this is a kind of avatar that of the 14th century that Dunworthy is hearing himself. Now he is himself a medieval historian, a historian of medieval studies, and so he also understands the sonorous history of this great bell. And if you go to Oxford today, the bell that you will hear tolling at noon every day is in fact this very same bell, having been recast, rehung, but still ringing to mark lives and the inhabitants of Oxfordshire. There's a second object that joins together Kivrin and Dunworthy throughout this book, and it's a memory of a 14th century chronicle. In that same scene in the hospital where Dunworthy is trying to press the button to call for the nurse, where he's ringing the nightmarish, the bedside handbell that reminds him of a nightmarish Great Tom. He calls to mind a chronicler from the Middle Ages, a monk by the name of John Clynn. And he remembers a book that he has read in the Bodleian. Dunworthy called for help, but no one came. He thought that everyone else had died, and he was the only one left, like the monk John Klein in the monastery of the Friars Minor, I, waiting for death till it come. A quote from John Klein's chronicle, the reading in the Bodleian that in fact has been brought to our attention in Willis's book a few hundred pages earlier. On about 200 pages earlier, Dunworthy tells us and some others about the chronicle of John Klein, a Franciscan friar, who recounts the details of plague and devastation in 13th century Kilkenny in Ireland. And this is a quote from his chronicle. Unless things which should be remembered perish with time and vanish from the memory of those who are to come after us, he had written, I, seeing so many evils and the whole world, as it were, placed within the grasp of the evil one, being myself as if among the dead, I, waiting for death, have put into writing all the things that I have witnessed. John Klein had written it all down and then had apparently died himself all alone. His writing on the manuscript trailed off, and below it, in another hand, someone had written, and here it seems the author died. So when I first read Doomsday Book, I assumed that this was another one of Willis's fantastic imagined connections of 2014 and 1348. But it turns out that actually John Klein is a chronicler, and there is a surviving chronicle from Kilkenny that relates his experience during the Black Death. And this, I'm not sure if you can see all of this, but this is a part of that. It's the very last entry that the friar makes as an eyewitness to the ravages of the plague, and most probably one of its victims, dated June 1349. So again, like the bell of Big Tom, here is another kind of material thing, a chronicle, a book, that Willis cannily brings into her science fiction novel, fantasy novel, about time travel between these two places of pestilence. And you can see here, the second of these paragraphs is the one that Willis uses as provocation in her book to draw together Dunworthy and Dunworthy's reflections on his own mortality in the face of his delirium in the hospital. Now, happily, Dunworthy survives, and in fact, he will eventually go on time travel himself in order to try to rescue Kivrin from being stranded in the 14th century. Throughout those moments, as well as near the end of the book, all of these untimely objects, the bell, Christchurch Tower, John Clynn's Chronicle, draw us as contemporary readers into evocations of multiple times of pandemic that I think resonate strikingly with our own time as well. I began this presentation by having us all listen to Great Tom, hear the sonorousness of that bell tolling. And just 2 weeks ago in the Irish Times, Ronan McGreevy referenced John Clynes Chronicle. And I think we have a link to that Irish Times op-ed that will be put in the Facebook chat, so you can look at that yourself. This was startling to me when I was preparing this presentation and found that John Clyne, the figure that was so moving for Dunworthy and for Willis, became a source of inspiration, you know, in our own day as we reflect upon the pandemic that is that in which we are caught at the moment. So at the very end of the book, Kivrin gives us a kind of sense of the fundamental meaning of her her own doomsday book. Willis's novel is called Doomsday Book after, of course, the famous book that from the 11th century, 1068, William the Conqueror's book that surveyed much of the land of England and of Wales. But Kivrin's Doomsday Book brings her source material about medieval people and their responses to pandemic, and it casts in doubt some of the things that we often think about medievals. I'm not sure if you can. I can't see all of this to read it directly to you. But Kivrin reflects on the fact that the history videos about the Middle Ages say that in the Middle Ages, during the Black Death, people were panic-stricken and cowardly, and they all ran away and left the sick to die alone, and that the priests were the worst of all. But Kivrin, from her experience, can say, it isn't like that at all. Everyone is frightened, but they're doing the best they can, and Father Roach is wonderful. He sat and held the Reeve's wife's hand the whole time I examined her, and he doesn't flinch at the most disgusting jobs. He continues to pray, telling God about who has it now, reporting their symptoms, and telling what we're doing for them, as if God could actually hear him. Is God there too, I wonder, but shut off from us by something worse than time, unable to get through, unable to find us? That's the very experience that Dunworthy had in his hospital room in Oxford in 2054, the experience that Kivrin has helping Father Roche bury the dead in 1348. And I think it sort of is an experience that speaks, that resonates in an affective way to our own day, to our own worries about how it can be that even with all the medical advances, even with all of the best scientists in the world, even with Dr. Fauci, that we still are caught here, not really knowing what's ahead of us in these very unsettled times, not really knowing when we'll get a release from the time of COVID-19. On the very last page of Willis's book, Dunworthy, who has now arrived into the 1348 and has found Kivrin helping to bury the dead in Shrividan, links her to John Kline, the monk from Kilkenny. Like John Kline, Dunworthy thinks, looking at Kivrin's ragged hair, her dirty feet, writing in the empty church and surrounded by graves. He likens her to John Kline, the historian. For her part, Kivrin is thinking about all the people that she has loved. At this point, all of those she's become closest to have died. She is the only one left alive to bury the dead. Father Roach has just died. And she turned her palms up and looked at her wrists in the twilight, recording in the recorder that's in her wrist. Father Roach and Agnes and Rosamond and all of them, she said, I've got it all down. She then traced a line down the side of her wrist with her finger. You are here, she said softly, in the place of the friends that I love. Her memories, her recording of the events that she's experienced remind her, conjure the people that she has come to love in Oxford of 1348. I have a coda, because one of the things that's notable about Connie Willis's Doomsday book is that it was researched and written between 1987 and 1992, exactly the period during which, in the US anyway, the AIDS pandemic was developing. In 1987, AIDS was named a global health crisis. In 1989, the number of documented cases in the US numbered 100,000, and ACT UP was pressuring the relevant governmental agencies, including Tony Fauci, our very own Tony Fauci, to develop new protocols for therapeutic trials as a result. And in 1992, Tony Kushner's Angels in America, another fantasy text evoked by a time of plague, was on the stage in New York and named the winner of the Pulitzer Prize in 1993. I'm gonna stop now sharing my screen. I have a few more things to say, which is just that one of the things that has always struck my students as we read the Doomsday Book is the way in which it resists thinking of the Middle Ages either as the dark past that we have escaped in our progressivist future, or a kind of nostalgic golden age when people were more religious and kinder to each other. No, the whole gambit of Willis's book is to draw attention to the ways in which pandemic brings the same things out of people, whether in 1348 or 2054, that it draws the best out of people, even as it also is an occasion for prejudice and other kinds of superstitions. But what we learn by going back to the Middle Ages, what we see with Kivrin and the family of people that she comes to love, and Father Roach, who she comes to admire, despite the fact that his Latin is bad and he doesn't know how to read and his liturgy is not done very well. Despite all of that, she comes to appreciate him as probably the single savior of the town of Shrividan. And one of the things that the book does for me, the thing that it has done for my students, is really put flesh and blood on the bones of those medieval statistics of the millions of medievals who died in the Black Death. In the wake of COVID-19, we hear a lot about the numbers of cases, of deaths, of people on ventilators, of hospitalizations. One of the things that literature of contagion really does is remind us that every single one of those people, every single one of those victims of pandemic is individual for whom the bells of Oxford should ring, for whom mourning should be done, and that something is lost in looking at statistics and numbers, and that very thing that is gained by attending to the ethics and the affect that comes to us in literature of Contagion. So I hope that this has given you a little bit of a sense of Willis's marvelous book, and that those of you that haven't had a chance to read it will get yourself a copy. It's a great science fiction engrossing read, and something that really I think brings to mind all of the various historical pandemics and the people that have suffered under them. Thank you.
Thank you, Patty, for that really smart and poignant talk. I appreciate your sharing your ideas about the book with us tonight on the program. And I'm looking forward to having you on at the end. We can talk more about some of the echoes and reverberations across time that you're seeing in the book. So please, if you're watching along and if you have questions for Professor Ingham, please post them in the comments. We'll read them and we'll get back to them in a little bit. I'd like to turn now to our next speaker for the evening, Professor Linda Charnes. She's a professor of English at IU Bloomington. And Linda studies early modern culture through the Restoration and long 17th century. She is first and foremost a Shakespearean who has really changed what it means to be a Shakespearean. Her work explores Shakespeare in utterly contemporary ways. She studies the use of Shakespeare in the arenas of mass culture, literature, film, and contemporary international politics. And she herself uses Shakespeare's plays as a lens on all that we experience today, especially in a political context. And it's thrilling to experience our contemporary reality with her in this way. Her first book, Notorious Identity, Materializing the Subject in Shakespeare, showcased Shakespeare's use of legendary figures to critique emerging problems of fame and notoriety. And then her second book, Hamlet's Heirs, Shakespeare and the Politics of a New Millennium, traced the legacy of Shakespeare's most famous princes, Hamlet and Hal, and their impact, covert and overt, on contemporary British and American politics and society. Tonight, Linda is talking on the epidemiology of political disease in Hamlet, specifically as Shakespeare wrote during several plagues in London. And he came to use disease, plague, and infection as his primary allegory for political, social, and familial corruption. I'm very excited to present Linda Charnes and her work this evening. Please go ahead.
My provoking object tonight is obviously a skull. What I want to discuss is the connection between the contemplation of death, which is a very famous trope in Shakespeare, and the uses of nostalgia and of writing or creating a backstory. So there's no more famous image, perhaps representing literature, than the image of an arm extended, contemplating a skull. That may be almost, I'm not going to say universally, but in most cultures, people understand that that is an iconology or an iconography for Shakespeare's Hamlet. But I just want to spend a minute talking about skulls in relation to the slideshow that you just watched and the bizarre choice of music accompanying it. In Shakespeare's day, there would not have been any actual skulls on the stage. It would have been illegal. Perhaps it might have been possible for somebody from his company to bribe a charnel house or a grave digger into giving them a skull, but there would not have been there would not have been several skulls during a performance for the grave digger to dig up and toss about the stage. They would have been extremely fragile. So instead, Shakespeare's company probably carved skull images into large tubers, potato, probably being the largest, or a large turnip. The apple, I thought, was a stroke of genius on somebody's part. But it wasn't until the 18th century that it became possible to use actual human skulls for performance. The other thing that I want to say about the skulls, and just the image of the contemplation of the skull, is that if you were to ask the average person on the street what that represents, they might say, might likely say, that it represents Hamlet's to be or not to be speech. The fact of the matter is that there's no skull in that speech. There's no skull at all in the play until Act 5. And so it's very interesting that of all the possible scenarios or moments in the play, that the one that has become the most famous is one that does not happen until Act 5. Why the choice of Caroline? No. aside from trying to inject a little bit of levity into what's an extremely difficult time, the contemplation of the skull is a medieval and a Renaissance trope. In many of the paintings from the time, there will be on tables with books and, you know, early modern microscopes or telescopes, there will be a skull. And the skull obviously is a very famous memento mori, a reminder of death. And during the emergence of Renaissance humanism, there was always a sense that no matter how much things could accomplish, no matter how lofty mankind could become, there always needed to be a reminder that at the end, this is what everything would come to, this skull. And so it's become not just famous for Hamlet, but famous for an entire attitude towards human investigation and human enterprises. So what I would like to do in segueing my comments tonight into the topic of epidemiology and political disease is talk about the need for a backstory. Many of Shakespeare's plays provoke a desire in the audience for some kind of backstory, but most famously, King Lear seems to provoke a desire for a backstory, and you know, most recently, although it's been several decades, James Smiley's famous novel, 1,000 Acres, is a kind of response to that need for a backstory. But I think that there is not another play in Shakespeare's corpus that than Hamlet. And the most famous representation of that backstory is John Updike's novel, published in the year 2000, called Gertrude and Claudius. It's an extraordinary novel because what Updike does is he answers all the unarticulated questions that nevertheless sit brooding over the vast abyss of Shakespeare's Hamlet. Excuse me for one second. I have a whining dog. All right, he's not whining too loud. You can't hear him. I can. So somehow what the play Hamlet seems to do is it issues a series of questions that it never actually articulates. And the questions are raised, they are called to the floor, and yet they're never answered. And so what I want to do is just outline a few of the unarticulated questions in the play that seem to be the key to understanding what's actually happening in the play. And the first is a question of how did things come to this? And this is a question that is fleshed out literally in so many different ways in the play. How did Denmark get to this state of disease and disrepair? And of course, the most immediate symptom, if we're going to read for the symptoms, is how is it that Claudius is on the throne when Hamlet, who is in fact 30, although we don't discover that until Act 5, it's the gravedigger who's going to reveal that. Even though Hamlet is 30 and he's the only son and heir of the murdered king, he's not on the throne. And everybody in the play talks about him as an heir apparent, and yet nobody in the play says, "Why aren't you on the throne?" And so there's a kind of situation of silence and complicity. And Claudius, in a way, sets the tone for this in Act 1, Scene 2, in the big, this is after, in Act 1, when Hamlet has already encountered the ghost. In Act 1, Scene 2, we have a full court, and Claudius is greeting everybody, and he is telling them, yes, and I'll be paraphrasing quite a bit, he's addressing the full court, and Hamlet is there, and he's saying, yes, we're very sad about the death of our brother, King Hamlet, of course, but at the same time, we are also very merry because we have taken our former sister, now our bride, to wife. And of course, Claudius has married Gertrude. So there is an enormous problem in the play that has little, if anything, to do with the ghost. And so reading this play for the plot doesn't actually get us to the source of what's wrong in Hamlet. And to get to that, we have to perform a kind of epidemiological reading. I'm using that word carefully, advisedly, but epidemiology literally means, from the Greek, the study of what is upon the people. It's derived from the Greek epi, meaning upon or among, demos, meaning people or district, and logos, meaning study, word, or discourse. So epidemiology, as it's come to be used, obviously in medical ways, is the study of the origin of how a particular kind of disease has broken out, spread, and come to manifest in various ways among a given population. And Hamlet, the play, issues a demand to us. Not just a demand to study the epistemology of how we can know things. The play clearly raises that question when Hamlet himself is not sure about the veracity of the ghost. But the play throws so many symptoms in our path that it demands a kind of epidemiologist's eye. Something is rotten in the state of Denmark. The only son, heir, and namesake is not on the throne. How did this come to happen? And how is it that Gertrude could so hastily marry her late husband's brother? So for Hamlet, rather than addressing these questions front and center, instead he resorts to a certain kind of Caroline No nostalgia, wherein he reimagines repeatedly how his mother used to hang on his father's every word, and he idealizes the fantasy of what he thinks their marriage was, and he cannot comprehend, and he will not comprehend, and he will die at the end of the play still not comprehending how it is that Gertrude could have gone from this figure that he idealizes in ways that are highly problematic to his brother. How could she have gone from this to this? And Hamlet doesn't understand it. He can't accept it. But there is something getting in the way of him carrying out his revenge. And if we actually read for all the symptomology in the play, one possibility that several Shakespeare scholars, myself included, have raised is the demand for a backstory that suggests that Claudius may indeed be Hamlet's biological father. Now, there's no way to know this for certain, but there's also no way, if we read the play carefully, to escape having to ask this question. And so asking this kind of question, this is exactly what John Updike was doing in his novel Gertrude and Claudius. How long had Gertrude and Claudius been involved? Why did the late King Hamlet, old Hamlet, who was murdered, why did he never set up a will to take care of his son? And why does Hamlet hesitate to take any action? And this is a question that Hamlet himself is going to beat himself up for repeatedly in his soliloquies. He's going to ask himself, how is it that I have strength and will and means to kill Claudius, and yet I still haven't done it? And so the play raises this issue of delay in the face of evidence. And here is where I want to segue into our contemporary crisis moment, because if you can hear my dogs, I apologize on their behalf. There was knowledge about the novel coronavirus. There was knowledge about the potential for an epidemic. People remained silent. In Hamlet, Claudius is only on the throne because people remained silent. In Act 1, Scene 2, he says to the court, nor have we herein barred your greater wisdom, which has freely gone along, for all our thanks. And so he is addressing the unspoken question, why, Claudius, have you ascended to the throne? When Hamlet is here, he's back in court, he's fit, he's 30 years old, he's obviously the heir apparent. But nobody challenges Claudius. Maybe they've been rewarded well, like Polonius probably has. Maybe they've been promised greater fortunes for allowing it to go on. Or maybe they're afraid Maybe they're afraid to speak up. And so silence and complicity in the face of a diseased elephant in the room become the harbingers of a situation in which not only is the time out of joint, as my friend and colleague Patty put it in her presentation, but something is indeed rotten in the state of Denmark, but everybody has a hand in allowing it to remain rotten. So what does Hamlet have to teach us about the current moment with the COVID crisis and people in positions of authority? And here is where I want to introduce the idea again, bring it back in again, of nostalgia. A week or so ago, can't remember the exact date, President Trump was asked during a presser, what his strategy was and what he wanted to see the outcome be of the response to COVID-19 in the country. And he said, and here I'm paraphrasing, he said, I want things to go back to the way they were. I want things to go back. I want us to go back. I want us to go back to where we were before. And we will go back to where we were before. So this idea of death staring one in the face, instead of contemplating what that means, what it means that, as Hamlet says in the gravedigger scene, tell my lady, let her paint an inch thick, to this she will come. She will come to this skull. What it means to actually contemplate close up and for real the utter materiality, the reality of death. And instead of directly confronting what that means and doing something to cure the political disease, instead wishing that things would go back to the way they were. So I think that I'm going to wrap up by hoping that the selection of Caroline No now resonates in your head with Gertrude No. How can you do this? There's no more remarkable play about refusals to confront what's staring you in the face than Shakespeare's Hamlet. And it has lessons to teach us that I think that we are all encountering every single day at the individual level as well as at the national level. And with that, I take my leave for the evening, and the rest is silence.
Talk. I really appreciate that. And thank you for sharing the pet sounds. And I don't mean your dogs. No, the interruptions were minor. I really appreciate it. Linda will be back with us at the end of the program, and I hope that you're able to share your questions with us so we can converse with her about them later on. Our final guest of the evening is Jenny McComas, and Jenny is a curator of European and American art at the Eskenazi Museum of Art at IU. She joined the Museum of Art as curator of Western art after 1800 in 2004, and she was appointed curator of European and American art in 2015. She manages a collection of nearly 6,000 paintings, sculptures, and decorative arts that represent artistic production from the Middle Ages to the present. Jenny's research interests include modern German art, the history of collecting and exhibitions, and the intersection of modern art and politics during the World War II and Cold War eras. Tonight, Jenny will be discussing the portrayal of death, mortality, and mourning from different religious perspectives in Western art. And her talk will include a discussion of a 1960 sculpture of a deceased figure titled Lazarus by the American artist Leonard Baskin. So please welcome Jenny McComas to the program. Thank you, Jenny.
Great. Thank you so much. It's really exciting to be here and share a little bit of the museum's collection with you. Hopefully some of our audience watching this program tonight made it into the Eskenazi Museum of Art sometime between November and the middle of March. We had reopened after a roughly 3-year closure, major renovations. Our galleries were completely reinstalled. Of course, we are again closed temporarily. But the sculpture that I'm focusing on tonight is on view in the gallery. And so the experience of seeing a work of art in person is always much better than seeing it in reproduction or on a screen. So try to keep that in mind, and hopefully at some point before too long, you'll be able to come over and see the piece in person. So the topic tonight is illness, contagion, and death. I'm going to be focusing primarily on the representation of death. And you know, these days, death has really become a part of our lives in a way none of us, particularly in the 21st century, were prepared for. You know, perhaps we know someone who has passed away from COVID-19. Or maybe we are just trying to process the grim fatality statistics that we hear reported daily in the news. Tonight, I'll be talking about how artists have confronted death, and especially mass death, in their work. I'm not really going to focus so much on the mass death caused by epidemics or pandemics, although that is always in the background. Instead, I'll be talking about one of the other horrific events of the 20th century, the Holocaust, and how that has impacted the visual arts. But first, I'm going to just talk a little bit about some earlier precedents, and we'll look at how European artists in earlier centuries have often dealt with the portrayal of death, particularly in times when death from warfare or from epidemics, such as the Black Death, was much more common. So let me share my screen here. Often in European art, and say in the Middle Ages and the Renaissance, we'll see imagery that presents death from a moralizing perspective. And I'm so glad that I put this painting in my presentation after hearing Linda's discussion about Hamlet and the iconography of the skull. Because we see a skull very prominently portrayed here in this Spanish painting from 1672. This is a genre of still life known as a vanitas, which, as Linda pointed out, are types of images meant to remind the viewer of the transience of life, the inevitability of death. Maybe these could be considered paintings for pessimists. Now moving on a little bit, actually this is going back in time somewhat to the late Middle Ages. The most ubiquitous scenes of death in Christian art are those portraying the death of Jesus Christ by crucifixion and the resurrection 3 days later. We have here, also from our collection at the museum, the wing of an altarpiece, and this is depicting the resurrection of Christ. These resurrection images are quite different from the vanitas images, which remind us of the inevitability of death, something we should just accept. The resurrection images, on the other hand, are much more about overcoming death, if only in a spiritual sense. But now moving on to the object of my presentation. This is a sculpture by the American artist Leonard Baskin, a work from 1960 cast in bronze, Lazarus. Despite the title of my talk, which mentioned I would be discussing works from religious perspectives, this is not a religious work in any traditional sense, but it does offer us insight into the Jewish perspective on death, and particularly in the post-Holocaust era. Recall, this work was made 15 years following the end of World War II. So in Baskin's sculpture, we see an upright, lifeless male figure The body is completely wrapped in shrouds. We see only the figure's face, and the closed eyes indicate his deceased state, despite his standing posture. Baskin is known for incorporating many references to Judaism into his work, and along with Hebrew inscriptions. So it's a little bit jarring, in fact, to find that the sculpture is titled Lazarus, after the figure mentioned in the Gospel of John, who Jesus raised from the dead 4 days after his burial at the request of his family. Now, in the Christian tradition, this miracle of resurrection prefigures Christ's own death and resurrection. But for Baskin, the concept of resurrection may have had a quite different connotation, and that's something I'll discuss later on towards the end of the presentation. I first want to provide a little bit of background about the artist. Leonard Baskin was born in 1922 in New Jersey. His family moved to New York when he was a child. He was the son of an Orthodox rabbi, and between the ages of 7 and 14, he attended a yeshiva, a Jewish religious school, where he gained a strong grounding in the Hebrew language and in Jewish texts, particularly Torah and Talmud. After deciding as a teenager to become an artist, Baskin rejected his Orthodox background, and by the 1930s, he was often, in fact, expressing ambivalence about Judaism and about religious practice in general. But the Holocaust, or the Shoah, as it's known in Hebrew, forced him to return to his roots, at least in his art. In 1943, partly in response to news then filtering into the United States about the Holocaust, he enlisted in the Navy, and he served in the Pacific as an anti-aircraft gunner. At the end of the war, as more visual documentation of the Holocaust was becoming available, he started to collect press photographs from Buchenwald, Dachau, and other concentration camps. And these included many images of corpses. I want to point out that he would also, of course, have been aware of the Nazis' appropriation of the language of disease and infection to justify their attempted extermination of the Jews, who were presented as an infection in German society, in Nazi ideology. Now, in part because the Nazis so dehumanized the Jews, the death of the Holocaust was utterly unprecedented in its scale and in its violence. So afterwards, artists struggled to find ways to visualize their responses to it, especially, and this was especially the case in the immediate post-war years. We find artists exploring various directions, trying to find some kind of visual language that felt significant enough to convey their horror. So some artists actually turned to Christian imagery to express a quote-unquote universal message about death and suffering. Christian imagery being a thought to be widely understood by the general public. And a well-known example is in the work of Marc Chagall, who painted numerous images of crucifixions, yet he clearly connected that imagery to the Jewish suffering of the day, as in this painting called White Crucifixion, painted actually before the outbreak of the war in 1938, but showing already persecutions that were occurring in Jewish communities, and of course, which had gone back into the 19th century. Now, other artists turn to abstraction, seeing figurative art as too banal or otherwise inadequate to capture the enormity of the Shoah. One example is a series created by the American abstract painter Morris Lewis. These are a series of works known as the charred journal paintings. They're from the early 1950s. They allude to the Nazi book burnings. We particularly know this from the title. And this one includes as well a Star of David, but the message is really not all that explicit. So the difficulties artists experienced in representing the Holocaust and their reactions to it really contrast very sharply with the situation during and after World War I, which inspired some of the most powerful art of the 20th century. Here's just one example, again from the Eskenazi's collection, a charcoal drawing by the German expressionist artist Otto Dix, showing casualties on a battlefield. But as horrible as the trenches and the battlefields of World War I were, they couldn't compare with the evil perpetrated by the Nazis. And as I've mentioned, many artists felt that their attempts to visualize this evil just fell short. Some artists found themselves unable to address the Holocaust in their work at all, or not explicitly, until maybe 15 or 20 years after the end of the war. And this is partly for psychological reasons, because time was needed to emotionally process what had happened. And remember too that some of these artists were themselves refugees from Europe, and others had lost family members in the Holocaust. We begin to see a shift to more direct engagement with the Holocaust in artworks created in the early 1960s. So this is an important moment when the Federal Republic of Germany, or West Germany, was beginning to face its role as the perpetrator of genocide, something that had really remained unspoken throughout most of the 50s. This new honesty, this reassessment of its role, so to speak, was prompted in part by the capture, trial, and execution in Israel of Adolf Eichmann, one of the primary architects of the so-called final solution. The events with Eichmann took place between 1960 and 62. So this is, again, the period when Leonard Baskin created his Lazarus sculpture. But Baskin had already been grappling with death and genocide in his work, in fact, for over a decade. In 1949, Baskin began a series of works in both sculpture and graphics known as the Dead Men. And I'm showing you one example here. The Dead Men pieces typically depict fragmentary or otherwise physically blemished figures, usually in reclining poses to emphasize their state of death, of lifelessness. Baskin was initially reticent to connect these works to the Holocaust, instead trying to give them a universal interpretation, and arguing, moreover, that it was beyond the capacity of any artist to adequately address the Holocaust for the reasons I've already discussed. However, ultimately, some years later, he did acknowledge that the Dead Men were in fact influenced by the Holocaust, and in particular by those documentary images that he had collected of the concentration camps at the end of the war. I will say, though, that he never used his images as direct sources to base his compositions on. Instead, he drew on European traditions, on medieval Renaissance art, and particularly German expressionist traditions as stylistic sources, rather than, so again, there's a little bit of a remove, of a distance. His works evoke the horrors of the 20th century, but filtered through a more long-standing European artistic tradition. So Lazarus is, I think, clearly related to Baskin's Dead Men series, but we do see some significant differences in the composition. So first of all, Lazarus is standing, and he appears, as much as we can tell, to be physically intact, not disfigured in any way, although, of course, he is in burial shrouds, so it's not totally possible to tell. However, this figure's dignity is intact, and we can also connect with him on an individual level. And this is because we can see his face and we know his name. So by contrast, the dead men of the 1950s who are nameless, they're just called dead men, they don't have names, those function more as statistics or as symbols for the millions of unknown nameless dead of the war. Now, the sculpture Lazarus is not mentioned when scholars describe Baskin's Holocaust-related work, And none of the sources that I've read on Baskin does his work come up as being at all influenced by his response to the Holocaust. But in part prompted by these very clear visual differences we see between Lazarus and the dead men sculptures, I want to propose that there is an additional layer of meaning embedded in this sculpture, which may have been overlooked, and that through Lazarus, Baskin is contrasting normative Jewish burial practices with the egregious way that the dead were treated during the Holocaust. Further, I also want to point out that the sculpture conveys, or may convey, a hope for Jewish survival in the post-Holocaust era. Now, in Jewish tradition, when a person passes away, the body is supposed to be buried within 24 hours of death. The body is considered the vessel for the soul, and the soul is not considered free of the body, until burial has taken place. So the body is ritually prepared for burial through a process known as tahara, which means purification in Hebrew. Members of a burial society known as a chevra kadisha ritually wash the body according to a prescribed process, and this also includes certain prayers and blessings. Generally, 4 or 5 people take part in this process. They then wrap the body in shrouds and sometimes a tallit, a prayer shawl, and we see the figure of Lazarus wrapped in this manner in the shrouds. Now, everything about the process of tahara and burial encourages a quick decomposition of the body so that it can return to the earth quickly. The Hebrew language emphasizes the connection between humans, Adam, and the earth, Adama. So to this end, embalming is prohibited by Jewish law, and the coffins are often that are used are generally simple wooden boxes. In Israel, the body, in fact, may be placed directly in the ground. Once the tahara is completed, people who function as sort of guards, known as shomrim, sit with the coffin until the time of the funeral. And it's as a sign of respect for the deceased person, again, that the body is never left unattended until the moment of burial. After burial, the traditional prayer for the dead, the mourner's kaddish, is recited. And the Kaddish, interestingly, must be recited with a minyan, which means a group of 10 adult Jews, and not alone, not by oneself. So this emphasizes the responsibility of the community to support the mourners. Likewise, the bereaved family sit Shiva for 7 days following the burial. And this is, again, a time when friends visit, often bringing food and staying with the family. So with Lazarus, what we have is a portrayal of what did not happen to the bodies of the Holocaust victims. Baskin is showing us what should happen. He's showing us the correct handling of a deceased person's body. As we know, the bodies of Holocaust victims were treated with the opposite of respect, since they were dumped into mass graves or cremated, which is a practice also prohibited by traditional Judaism. So I want now to return to Baskin's titling of the sculpture with the name of a New Testament figure who was raised from the dead. As I already mentioned, I don't think Baskin was especially interested in the Christological overtones of the Lazarus story, but more in the notion of resurrection itself, of coming back from nothingness, from death. In Judaism, the concept that the dead would be revived during the Messianic age first emerged during the early rabbinic era, so that's about 2,000 years ago, and it remains a core belief, particularly in Orthodox Judaism, so that, again, is Leonard Baskin's background. In Lazarus, it's likely that Baskin wanted to express the concept of resurrection or revival in metaphorical terms that could be understood in a variety of ways by different viewers. For the average viewer, the sculpture's title brings up general associations with resurrection, at least if one is familiar with the story of Lazarus. And for those familiar with Jewish burial practices, additional meanings that I've surveyed already can be detected. So according to the Israeli art historian Ziva Amishai Mazels, who wrote an authoritative text on the art of the Holocaust, Baskin believed that the emphasis on survival is absolutely essential within Judaism. In his lifetime, the establishment of the State of Israel provided a political means for Jewish survival, but it was the events that took place in the early 1960s, such as the trial of Adolf Eichmann and the beginnings of public reflection in Germany about the Nazi era, that offered some new hopes for Jewish life in the diaspora, and that was in part by making it more acceptable to openly address the traumas experienced by Jewish communities. So in the very year that that Baskin created the Lazarus sculpture in 1961, he wrote an article in which he emphasized the miraculous nature of Jewish survival despite millennia of persecution, exile, and tragedy. He wrote that Jews have, quote, the miraculous facility to wear bloodstain with honor, to defy malice while enduring it, not to crack under any incivility, however barbaric. So with Lazarus, I'd like to suggest that Baskin is offering a meditation on the revival of the Jewish people after the mass death of the Holocaust. Although the figure is dead, he stands up, and his body has been appropriately prepared for burial, indicating the presence of a living community invested in carrying on ancient traditions. To conclude, I'd like to turn in a different direction and reflect that for viewers in 2020, Baskin's sculpture has a poignancy and a meaning that he could never have imagined. In 1960, Baskin sculpted a deceased body properly prepared for burial according to Jewish tradition. Today, those traditions, just like the burial practices of all religions, have to be temporarily rethought in light of the coronavirus pandemic. Many Jewish communities and others as well, I'm sure, are now holding funerals and again, in Jewish communities, shiva minyans or prayer quorums virtually over Zoom. The benefits of holding such events in virtual space is the ability of people who might normally not be able to travel to attend the event to be there after all. Although that does, it's still a poor substitute on an emotional level. Perhaps more challenging is what to do about the practice of tahara. And this is something that also has been altered, we think temporarily, but who knows, for health and safety reasons. So there's a Jewish ethical principle that emphasizes the importance of preserving life and health over all of the other rituals mandated in Jewish law. Two reasons why tahara is risky under our present circumstances is one, there's a concern if the deceased might have passed away from COVID-19. And two, when you have four or five people conducting the ritual in close proximity to each other, that is not in alignment with social distancing guidelines, of course. Therefore, many Jewish communities have now made the decision to suspend tahara for the time being, while others are still conducting the ritual, but with greatly enhanced safety precautions. I guess only time will tell if such changes that are now being made, we think temporarily, will in fact be temporary, or if more permanent changes will be a result of the pandemic we're currently living through. And I think that's something that that all people everywhere are grappling with at the moment, regardless of religious belief or other cultural practices. So just to finally conclude, I'll reiterate again that Baskin's sculpture Lazarus contains multiple meanings, some of which were intended by the artist, and others which we can read into the work now as an audience living in a later time, living through circumstances, certainly, absolutely not as horrific as the times that Baskin lived through, but certainly unsettling and disturbing in their own way. Lazarus is a sculpture that is ultimately about human dignity, and whether that human dignity means treating the deceased with respect or modifying long-standing traditions in order to protect the living. This is a time when we are all trying to survive, admittedly, again, in very different circumstances from those that Baskin was familiar with. But the sculpture reminds us not to focus only on the negative, even though we are surrounded by the negative and the times can feel so overwhelming, but it reminds us to also focus on the positive, as Baskin did by imbuing some references to hope and survival, even in a work about death. And thinking about survival, thinking about the future in a positive light, is critical for our own survival as humans living through a pandemic. So with that, I think I will wrap up and thank you so much.
Thank you, Jenny. Thank you for that excellent talk. I'm very excited to see the piece at the Eskenazi when the museum opens up again. I did not know it was there, and that's quite a find, and I appreciate you sharing your thoughts on it with us tonight. We're bringing our speakers back for a few questions. I just wanna say before we begin the discussion that I hope that everyone could join us here again on Facebook this Thursday at 6 for the next installment of Thursdays at Home. That's an arts and humanities variety show that brings the spirit of First Thursdays right to your living room. This week's program features Indiana Poet Laureate Emeritus Adrian Matika of IU Bloomington's English Department and architect Kelly Wilson from the Eskenazi School of Art, Architecture, and Design, and three musicians from the Jacobs School of Music, Roberto Plano, Paolo Del Negro Plano, and Ivan Maceda. So we're really excited to host those guests on Thursday night. And actually tomorrow night, the College of Arts and Sciences is beginning their new webinar series called Food for Thought. And that begins with a presentation by history professor Rebecca Spang on the history of restaurants and the way they've been impacted by COVID-19. That event begins tomorrow at 7 p.m. And I believe there's a link in the comments section on our feed so that can tell you how to join. That's exciting program starting tomorrow night. And just quickly, I really want to apologize to our speaker, Linda Charnes. We had some technical difficulties showing her slides before her talk. And I had the pleasure of seeing them yesterday, and there's some amazing images of skulls and different skull carvings, especially in tubers. And stills from various productions of Hamlet, of the graveyard scene and Hamlet holding the skull. We are going to do our best to stitch those back into the presentation so people can see them when they rewatch the program or for future viewers. But Linda, I'm very sorry that happened, and our tech team also apologized. It did not at all diminish the impact of your talk though, and it was very clear. To me, at least, that the powerful points that you were making. So just a few questions for the three of you. I really appreciated the conjoining of thought and affect in all three presentations. I found that it's really a very dynamic and interesting mix. And it was great to kind of think and feel along with the three of you as you contemplate these objects of art and literature. I think the real thread that links these has to do with time, and particularly the time of response. And I really want to hear your thoughts about the kind of the work of the mind and the work of the intellectual in responding in a timely way to historical crisis, and how that works in your area. So my first question is, I have my entire library is in my garage right now. I recently moved, and I moved exactly during the week that the stay-at-home order was put into place. And so I've not opened my books. And every time I walk through the garage, I look at my books and I think that maybe I need to discard them. Maybe they don't apply anymore. And that when I go back to the classroom, those books won't mean much to this new generation of students. And then other times I think I have to cling to them desperately. So I'm wondering, when we all emerge and we all reappear Lazarus-like from this quarantine moment, what are you going to have with you, and what are you going to discard intellectually? What are the traditions, what are the ideas that are going to sustain you through this moment? And what are some things you might shed? Or what are some things that might not apply when you go back to teaching or you go back to writing? I know it's a big question, but I wish that maybe each of you can just name one or two things that you're holding on to or that you might be getting rid of intellectually at this time. Would anyone care to start?
It's a big question.
I know it is.
I mean, I guess that I would just start by noting that that in the wake of this, these other presentations too, I've been thinking a little bit about memorials for the dead. You know, about, you know, in all three of the presentations, whether Hamlet's graveyard scene or the Jenny's really thoughtful comments about the need to honor and bury the dead, and so I think I guess one of the things that I would then want to keep with me are the ways in which the ways in which we entomb the dead in our own reading practices and teaching practices, not at all in a way of avoiding survival, but precisely as a mode of precisely as an act of survival, precisely as a way of thinking about what is allowed to survive. I mean, I'm thinking about that figure of John Klein in the Willis book, who is the last person there, doesn't know that his words will survive, and leaves open, you know, a blank space in the parchment for someone to come after him. And so I do want to say, don't get rid of your books. And but also, you know, there may be ways in which our annotation practices with regard to our books might be more evocative of maintaining a tie with those who have died.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. Yes. Linda or Jenny, do you have anything to add?
I mean, I think that what the pandemic situation is showing us, and I think what this series of programs, arts and humanities programs, is illuminating so well, is the relevance of the past to the present and what we can learn and take away from the past. You know, I certainly would never have thought about our Lazarus sculpture as being all that relevant to the present day until I started living through a quarantine and a pandemic. And so I think maybe two things. One is trying to maintain always an awareness of what people have gone through that we can learn from today, and keeping an open mind to how our responses to the works of art and literature of the past are going to change, and to be open-minded about accepting those responses as valid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Linda?
So many thoughts. And as Patty said, it's a huge question. Two things popped into my head. What I want to see, what I'm going to need to have when this is over, is I'm going to need to be in a classroom with my students. I'm going to need to be in the same space with them. That this kind of teaching, when you're doing something like Shakespeare, it is impossible to properly embody what one needs to embody without being in the room with people. The other thought that I had is a few days ago, Bill Barr, Attorney General, was being interviewed, and he said, he was asked, how do you think history will look back on what you've done vis-a-vis General Flynn? And he said, well, history is written by the winners. And so, you know, enough said, right? That was the upshot. And it in the context of what we're talking about now, it reminds me of the very end of Hamlet, where Hamlet, as he's dying, asks Horatio, begs him, absent thee from felicity a while, and draw thy breath in pain to tell my story. Otherwise, what a wounded name I leave to the world. Somebody has to tell my story. But the problem is, of course, that Horatio doesn't know the story that we know, because Horatio was not present for the soliloquies and wasn't present for Hamlet's encounters with his mother and wasn't present for his encounters with Ophelia, and he just wasn't present for anything other than plot points. Mm-hmm. And so what I worry about, and you know, you framed the question around temporality, and right away what popped into my head is the past is prologue. The other thing is that the past is always with us. It's not the past, it's with us. And, you know, when you work on materials, and, you know, I think that all of us who were presenting tonight would agree with this, that it in a way, it's a kind of classic mistake of how we think about modern culture, to think that this carving up of time, to think that the past is the past. It's not. There are these temporal flows that repeat over and over, as Patty mentioned, and they will continue to repeat. And what strikes me is just, you know, to sum this up, two things. We need bodies in the room safely to convey the passion of teaching literature. We also need to, as a culture, as a society, to honor and respect the fact that all human cultures, going back thousands of years, have told stories. And that without stories about what our culture is and what it does, we don't exist for the future. So telling stories, being present, and speaking up is everything. And what I would hope for in the aftermath of all of this is that we return to conditions in which we can do those things.
If I could just add something to that, it was really beautifully said, Linda, but also I think, you know, just to sort of highlight an aspect of what you were talking about, which is the materiality, right, the surviving nature of materiality. And, you know, in all of the, whether we're talking about skulls or bells or
Lazarus statues, yes.
Right, or statues, you know, there is something really sticky about the material objects that the histories and the people and the times that surround them cling to them. Yes. And those same kinds of affects and concepts are passed on to the next group of readers, to the next group of artists, to the next group of gallery watchers, you know, or, you know, play attenders. And so I do really feel at this particular moment, because we are so, you know, we're zooming in and we're so sort of virtually with each other, a real pull on the materiality of things. And even if those things are a paperback novel or, you know, an Oxford edition of Hamlet, or, you know, a photograph of something that's in a frame. So I just feel, you know, the material object is calling to me, is making demands on me, and I want that to be more present in my thinking as I move forward when we get to be together again, when we get to be physically present to one another.
Yeah,
that's exactly why I started my presentation with the caveat that discussing a work of art in virtual space is really, it's not ideal. A work of art, I mean, especially a sculpture, like the one I talked about tonight, it is such a material object. You can see the artist's hand, literally his fingerprints and the surface of that sculpture. I don't think you can see that online on the Facebook feed. So this, certainly we are, there's something that we've really lost at the moment. You know, it's not that we have a choice, and thank goodness we have a virtual substitute, but there's, I know exactly, I really agree with what you're saying, that this almost needing a counterbalance of the material, the physical, and the tangible to balance out all the Zoom time, if nothing else, but also to remind us of the reality of human culture.
Yeah, that stories in the absence of people who are actually there to witness what's happening. Stories are flat. And so, you know, and I think about the end of Hamlet. Horatio says, I'll tell the story. Well, the story that he'll tell is going to be extremely abridged. It'll basically be the Cliff Notes version of Hamlet, a few plot points. And that's it, because he hasn't experienced what the play's actually about. And so this idea of being present and inside the history as it's happening, there has to be some correlation between that and the stories that get told. Mm-hmm. And that is something that I know that all of us are committed to, that correlation.
Right.
So I thought, I have one more question. I thought all three talks were very powerful in their claims about objects and the object world. And I felt that keenly, whether it was the bell that brings us together as a community, or the skull that grounds us in something finite, or the sculpture that, you know, sort of focuses our attention in interesting ways. And this recent line of thinking about presence and the now was really interesting to me as well. And I'm wondering about your relationship to the now and your positioning of yourself as an intellectual to the now. All three of you are historians, and, you know, by virtue of being on this program, you're asking to respond to now in a way. But as Linda's talk powerfully pointed out, particularly in terms of epidemiology, you know, theory is always catching up to the past in a way, is always belated in some form. And I think that Jenny was talking about, you know, artists sort of taking time to find a suitable response to extreme experience and new experiences. So I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you know, you as scholars, like the pressure of responding to the now and how you feel about that pressure. Is this something that is on your mind at all? Is it something that bugs you? Is it a demand that you do or do not want to have to meet at this time?
I'll start this time. I've been speaking to the demands of the present from the start of my career. And as you know, and I've been trying to imbricate these time periods. So thinking about what happens now, in a way, and I'll just be completely honest about, you know, I'll be completely honest about three things. One, I'm really, really pissed off that my dogs were whinging so loudly. Two, I'm very disappointed that my slideshow didn't show. Three, I don't know yet how to write about what's happening vis-a-vis the political psychology of the moment. And that's a new experience for me. So, we talk about how are we going to deal with the relationship between theory and material reality and what we're experiencing. And as literary scholars and historians and art historians, we are used to embedding how we look at things through the lens of ideology and critique. And the difficulty I have now, I can't speak for anyone else, is that ideology critique has been rendered useless by the current moment and the epidemiology of that fact will be written in the future. I hope I live long enough to be able to contribute to that, but I don't yet know what that's going to be.
Patty or Jenny?
So this has been a very challenging time for art museums, well, for all museums, but I'll talk about art museums specifically for a number of reasons. I mean, the first is that we depend on visitors. There's no reason to have a priceless collection of amazing works of art in an empty building that nobody can access. So although we have much of our collections online and we've been experimenting with giving virtual tours, for example, I gave one earlier in the week, and we're trying to be as innovative as possible with other kinds of online programming utilizing our collection. As I said before, this is really uncharted territory in many ways for a field that depends on objects and on having people interact with those objects in real time. So that's something that's challenging me as a curator and all of my colleagues. I also want to talk a little bit about another challenge that we're facing, which I think a lot of people aren't aware of, is the logistical issues with planning. So it actually takes us many, many years generally to organize a major exhibition that might entail bringing in loans from other institutions and a catalog and just so many different moving parts. And so right now we're facing a situation where we have to postpone exhibitions that have been planned for a long time. Some of other museums, we're actually a bit luckier. Some museums had just opened major exhibitions when the quarantine started and the exhibitions were canceled or closed after a couple of days. And that is, there was actually an article a few days ago in the New York Times about curators losing years of their life's work from the exhibitions being canceled. Now, often there is a catalog, so you do have something to show for the work. But again, our work really depends on people coming together with works of art and seeing those and having a real-time experience. What we're doing here at the Eskenazi Museum is really shifting to thinking about our work in a more in the now moment, in fact, as you put it, because it's a little bit difficult to make very long-term plans. At least we don't know when we'll reopen exactly. We don't know when it's safe to schedule a major exhibition. So again, we are trying to think more nimbly. What can we do right now, right here with the resources we have online? So I think it's challenging all of us, myself included, to think about how we engage with our audiences in a new way. And I think it remains to be seen how that might change our scholarship, but I'm sure it will. And I think that's it's just something that, I've been on several other like Zoom discussions with curators around the country, and we've been discussing these issues and try to learn from each other, but it's definitely causing a shift in the profession.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think my response is going to be a little more melancholic. So, apologize for that. For those of you that are, ready for some, cheerier stuff. But one of the things that I've been thinking about, and this has been something that I've thought a lot about in my previous scholarship as well, is that what it means not to be at the end of something, but to be in the middle of something. I often find with books I love, I hate to get to the end, because then the culmination is over and want to sort of try to kind of recapture what it feels like to sort of be in the middle of things. I love Geoffrey Chaucer. I'm a medievalist. I teach Chaucer all the time. And one of the best parts of the Canterbury Tales is that it doesn't ever end. The pilgrims never get to Canterbury because it's unfinished. And so they're always kind of on the road. Chaucer wrote the Canterbury Tales, was kind of inspired by Boccaccio, but instead of having his storytellers sit in a castle and tell stories to each other while they waited for the plague to come and get them, he took his storytellers out on the road. And so there's something that I've been trying to think a little bit about, being kind of in the middle of what it feels like to be in the middle of the now, because we don't know whether we'll get to be in classrooms together. We don't know, when the vaccine will come. So what it means to kind of embrace the middle. And so there's two ways that I think that, liberal arts provide kind of tools for living about being in the middle. And one of those is a quote I'm gonna butcher by Jeffrey Hartman about poetry. And it's something like this: poetry, like life itself, exists in the indeterminate middle, between life and death, between birth and death, two overly specified poles always threatening to collapse. And so I just found on my phone one of the poems by Denise Levertov that I think kind of evokes this. It's very short and it's called Living. Just gonna read it off my phone. Mm-hmm. The fire in leaf and grass, so green, it seems, each summer, the last summer. The wind blowing, the leaves shivering in the sun, each day, the last day. A red salamander, so cold, so easy to catch, dreamily moves his delicate feet and long tail. I hold my hand open for him to go, each minute, the last minute. There's a way in which the literature that I read at its best, or at my best, inspires me to try and live as if each minute were the last minute, to be in the middle of every minute. And that's something that both conceptually, but also I just think experientially and emotionally, that I'm trying to sort of think about at a time when it's very difficult to focus, it's very difficult to be productive, it's very difficult to write, it's very difficult to organize a library, but we can still, read a poem or, grab or listen to a bell or a song in a way that sort of brings us, I think, into the experience of the immediacy of art and the immediacy of the life of the mind.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, beautifully put. Yes, Linda.
Yeah, beautifully put. And to be in the middle of the now, I mean, that is such a perfectly eloquent capture of where we are. And as you were talking, Patty, I was thinking about, how do we then, if we're going to try it, well, we did not try. We are living in the middle of the now. And the now is almost instantly demanding changes of us as teachers, changes of us in terms of our pedagogy, in terms of how we think about our fields. And what went off in my head as you were talking, Patty, was that, you know, how do we create, if we need to be online in the fall semester, which we may very well need to be, how do we, and we, you know, we began, most of us, we had 8 weeks in person, and then we switched to this, but how do we use the space to recreate differently a sense of intimacy, and that our sense of boundaries will have to shift pedagogically. You know, how we engage students will have to shift and change. And I think that what I loved about your, you know, in the middle, living in the middle of the now, that the now has a, you know, it has a kind of ghostly edge to it. It has a leading ghostly edge, and it is a trailing ghostly edge, and we're somewhere in the middle of it, and those edges will only become defined once we've figured out what to create in the middle of the now. And so, you know, how do we, and I think that the humanities are especially well equipped to navigate this. And I'm not going to say as opposed to, you know, the hard sciences, but in terms of bodies of knowledge and transmissibility and what different disciplines study and how they regard what it is they do, we, as humanists, we're not about just transmitting standard or stock readings of anything, whether it's art or sculpture or novels or, you know, whatever it is. That's not what we are about. That's not what we do. We mobilize real-time engagement with everything that we teach. And yet, now we've been forced to kind of go into two dimensions. So how are we going to be present? How are we going to make, what techniques can we use to make presentness and three-dimensionality mean something if we're forced onto, you know, and thank God for these platforms. As Jenny said, I mean, you know, thank God we have it, but still, what we make in the middle of the now is going to be what the story is in the future.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, I want to thank the three of you, first of all, for willing to go a little meta with me at the end of this evening, but also to speak so thoughtfully and in such an upfront way about what you might be experiencing right now as scholars. I appreciated your talks as well as this chance to think a little bit more about the work of scholars today. So thank you. Thank you deeply. I'd like to just let the audience know that that they can join us next week for another episode of Quarantine Conversations, when our topic will be humanism, public policy, and medical practice. And we have three scholars who will join us to talk about empathy, patient care, and humanistic training for healthcare professionals, doctor-patient communication, and how humanities perspectives can inform healthcare policies. So a shift in theme, but I'm sure just as pressing and poignant of a topic today. Thanks again to my three presenters, Jenny, Patty, and Linda. It's been a real pleasure. I appreciate your time and your thought and joining me on this program tonight. So please take care.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Good night.